Well, I was careening through the endless whirlpool of entertainment, that is YouTube, just earlier this morning, and I saw something that made my pop culture antenna tingle. It's a trailer for a new movie, which we will show you a little bit of and make sure that we don't make any money off of this. Hi, everybody. I'm Bill Whittle with Steve Green and Scott Ott. And this is your right angle on a trailer that I saw this morning for a movie called Blood Red Sky. Not going to play all of it, but we'll just play just a little bit and we'll see if you catch what I caught.
Don't touch me, okay?
Was this yours?
Ladies and gentlemen,
as you can see, we have control of the plane. We want this operation of ours to go off without a hitch. If not,
Elias!
Use your imaginations.
One of them's on.
It's the only way to stop them. Or they're going to kill everyone on board.
Okay, guys. Look, actually, the effects look kind of cool. But basically, this is vampires on a plane. You know? Get these motherfucking vampires off this motherfucking plane. There. That's basically what it's all about. In any event, did you happen to catch what I caught? Because watching this, this is what I saw. I saw a movie where the bad guys are white American males with guns hijacking a plane. And we are going to be depending on the vampire to save us from the white American males with guns. You see, I'm not aware that a group of Americans have ever hijacked an airplane or anything. If we decide that we need to bomb something, we have an air force. That's what we do. But nevertheless, this is the only villain left. And this isn't even about the whole white thing. We see this every day. Steve, I do this when I do speaking events and it just really grabs people. I say to them, I will go into a room of people and I say, how many of you have ever been hypnotized? And two or three people might put their hands up. I say, no, you've all been hypnotized. You've been hypnotized thousands and thousands of times in your life and you don't even know it. And I can prove it to you. I'm going to start a sentence and you can finish it for me. Ready? Here we go. Look, up in the sky, it's a bird. The entire room goes, it's a plane, it's Superman. And to which I reply, you didn't have to go to the website for that. You didn't have to search your memory. You didn't have to, what was it? You didn't know. You knew it. And you knew it because for a certain generation at a certain age, that goes right into your brain because you'd heard it hundreds of times. And because you know it's a bird, it's a plane, it's Superman, everything that Superman represents goes in there too. Truth, justice, and the American way. Unlimited power constrained by his own morality. All of that is in your head because you know, look up in the sky, it's a bird, a plane, Superman. What this is doing, it is programming a generation for us to be the villains in our own culture. Again.
I just want to say, Superman, strange visitor from another world with powers and abilities far beyond those of mortal men. I used to have that whole intro memorized when I was
a little
kid.
It's
the only
bullet.
Line I still remember all of, and I just get all tingly remembering those just so low budget George Reeves Superman shows. I loved them. Were you about to say something, Bill?
I was just going to say this, Steve. When we talk about having this stuff in our head, we all of us agreed watching the TV show that this guy in his mid-40s, who's not particularly muscular, don't get me wrong, I loved him, right?
Oh, yeah.
But he's not exactly like this, you know,
no,
cut
he's
guy.
Wearing a
he's wearing,
suit.
He's wearing, it's a middle-aged guy wearing tights. But we all agree that this guy can jump And then we're going to cut to him on a wire or something. And we're all going to agree that this guy can fly. And by lowering our disbelief and allowing this into our head, everything that came with it came with it. We're going to watch a movie here with vampires on a plane, and we're going to lower our disbelief. We're going to lower our critical thinking because we want to be entertained. Yes. And so we're going to see this movie about vampires on a plane, but we are also going to see that the bad guys are once again white males with guns who, as far as I know, have never hijacked a plane as a group in my life.
Here's the thing. My two favorite kind of movies combined make my favorite kind of movie. The first are a high concept pictures. These are the ones, high concept does not mean elevated. It means
it's a 1 second pitch, one line pitch.
Exactly. Can you explain the movie in one line or even just with the title? Yes. My other favorite kind of movie is an exploitation flick. You show me a movie title like The Thing with Two Heads or Twins of Evil or Countess Dracula, I'm all over it. And when you've got a high concept exploitation flick like Snakes on a Plane, I'm going to have my ass in a chair on opening day. The problem is Snakes on a Plane, just it didn't deliver the goods. I was very disappointed by that movie. But the big problem here is the laziness in Hollywood. Part of it is the hypnosis thing you're talking about. The other part is it's become such a trope to make the white guy, usually the rich white guy, the villain. The first time I remember this happening was in the Ben Affleck adaptation of Tom Clancy's Some of All Fears, which started off with a fairly believable premise that a lost Israeli nuke from the 1973 war that got dropped on Syria. The material is found 25 years later by Arab terrorists who then use it to make a new nuclear bomb and they blow up the Super Bowl in Denver. In the movie version, it was neo-Nazis in Austria.
Yeah, it's like white supremacists trying to raise the price of the Krugerrand or some insane thing like this, yeah, right? Yeah.
What the hell? It's become such a trope that, you know, I love the MCU movies, the Marvel movies. They did 22 movies telling a single story, which nobody had ever done anything like this, and it was great. But there are some really weak moments, like in Captain America, the Winter Soldier. As soon as I can't believe I just forgot his name, Butch and Sundance.
Robert Redford?
Robert Redford, thank you. As soon as Robert Redford on the Good Guy World Council walks on the screen for the first time in his nice suit and his hair, I'm like, oh, great, he's the bad guy. And sure enough, he is the bad guy. They did it again in Iron Man 3, where they took a perfectly good comic book villain, the Mandarin, and made him a puppet of the evil rich white guy. And it's
lazy.
As a movie lover, it's I'm not so worried about the hypnosis, because what Hollywood is doing, I think, is a very small part of what the progressive left is doing. And we got to fight them on all fronts. This is just another one. But they're making the movies worse. Cut it out.
Yeah. And they're ruining the ones that were good. Star Trek and Star Wars. I consider that a form of stolen valor. We're going to basically clothe ourselves in these uniforms that people love and admire so that we can gain that respect without having paid for it.
Oh, did you hear the latest, Bill?
What's that?
Disney demanded that Lego take the name off of Boba Fett's spaceship, the Slave One.
Did they?
Yeah, that just came out yesterday, Monday.
Okay.
It's been called that since 1980.
Because
slave.
Yeah, well, so you can't, you know, here's the thing, since you brought that up. If you don't have slaves in your story, then you can't have rebellion against slavery, can you? You can't have overcoming slavery if you don't have slavery in the first place. But let's just put that aside. Scott, I saw something recently that said that the majority, it's a relatively thin majority, but it's still a majority now, of young people are ashamed of the United States. They're ashamed of being Americans. This is one drop in an ocean that just has been rolling and rolling and rolling and rolling and rolling. But that's why it got my attention. Culture and the population and the artists have this kind of revolving feedback loop where the population wants something, artists give it to them, but the artists can be the one to change this cycle. The classic example for me was Bonnie and Clyde, the Warren Beatty movie. Here you've got the best looking man in the world, and you got this beautiful woman and a fantastic filmmaker, and they're making these two murderers into heroes. I saw a film that came out just a couple years ago called The Highwayman about the guys who actually went after and caught Bonnie and Clyde. Much better movie, but it did nothing. And so once you begin to see, once enough artists start putting the anti-hero on the screen, you start looking for this and you start believing it. And not to get too far off of this, but I was a jury foreman a couple years ago, and during the deliberations, everybody said, oh, we can't trust that testimony from that cop. Why? He's lying. Well, what makes you think that? They think that because there's got to be a twist, right? There's always a twist. This is storytelling. He can't be telling the truth. There's got to be some secret person behind the scenes who's responsible for this. And we are manufacturing the poison that we're injecting into our own system. And it's our job to at least put a warning label on it.
It's interesting that there are a lot of TV shows, series, and movies that I've watched. And inside me, there's a little guy kind of rooting for this person who has some redeeming characteristics but is behaving in a bad way, for him to turn and for him to be redeemed. And I really get angry, not like I don't explode at my wife or anything, but inside I'm thinking, why did you string me along all this time just to leave this guy in the gutter? Isn't the whole purpose of this journey for this guy to learn from his mistakes and for him to turn and to create some value in the world, to do something good, to help somebody, to save somebody? And I think that that's what's lost. Like, if you're ashamed of the United States, it's not like you have some other set of facts that I don't have access to, because the United States is filled with people like me. Broken, sinful people who do wrong things in addition to occasionally doing right things. And we could choose to focus. I could look at myself and say, you know what? I have done so many wrong things all my life. I should be ashamed of myself and just wallow in that shame. I should live in a constant state of embarrassment. I should hide my head and never go out in public because of the despicable human being I am, because of all the intentionally wrong things and accidentally wrong things that I have done. If I chose to live that way, I'd be fondling a revolver. But that's not how I choose to live. And maybe it's because of my faith in Christ, but I don't know if I had this view before I was saved when I was 28 years old. But I continually think that everybody, not me, but everybody around me has an opportunity to be redeemed, to turn, to become better, to take that bad situation and turn it to good. I always continue to have faith that things are going to improve, and I see my country the same way. I don't look back at the history of slavery and go, oh, that was a proud moment of civilization. No, but I think, wow, the progress that we've made since then and the progress we have still to make in racial relations and in justice and in making sure that we're not treating people in an oppressive manner, both in our personal lives and in our collective national lives. This is an opportunity. It is an unreasonable view of humanity to insist that we focus only on the shame and the embarrassment of previous behaviors without also looking at the positives, and more importantly, without also trying to be part of the reason for redemption, being part of the movement of people who says, you know, we may have done things wrong in the past, but I'm going to be part in my personal life and by extension through our governance in being part of change that makes life better for this country, for my neighborhood, and for all humanity.
Several years ago, I was watching a movie called The World's Fastest Indian. It's a story about a true story. I want to say he was Australian. It might have been New Zealand. Anthony Hopkins played the guy. He's a guy who built his own motorcycle and brought it to an Indian motorcycle is the name of the brand. Brought it to the U.S., wanted to set the speed record in a motorcycle, goes out to Bonneville Salt Flats and this whole thing. And I'm watching this movie, and needless to say, he constantly runs up against all these obstacles. And he does the race. And I waited the entire movie for the scene where this guy who we've come to love is killed or becomes cynical and gives up. Or no, it did. It was a happy ending. Could have knocked me out of my chair with a feather. It was like you end up liking this guy, loving this guy. He does this incredible thing, and then he survives, and it's like, well, damn. That's how bad things have gotten. When I was talking a minute ago about a cycle, here's how it works. You have a cynical artist that produces cynical artwork, and it gets and it makes the audience watching it more cynical. And then people who are making the decisions think, well, cynical is selling. And so they go even more in this direction. It's the it's the artist that leads it. And if you have a society that grew up on things like Superman or It's a Wonderful Life, you're going to have a different people than you will if you have one that grows up on Family Guy and things like, you know, Under Your Blood Red Sky, We cannot expect that we can be continue to be villains in our own mythology and not continue to pay the price. And yet, I continue to be more cheerful with every passing day, because no matter how hard they try, people just aren't buying it. They're not. They're just plain not buying it. They know what adventure is. They know what storytelling is. I just saw this morning. And I thought, well, I'm going to talk about it. I'm going to put a warning label on it just so you can appreciate how pervasive it is and how effective it is. But stories that move people in a direction of goodness and nobility resonate in a way that stories that move them towards cynicism and apathy and desperation and despair do not. There is a reason why good triumphs over evil, because it feels better. That's why. And no matter how hard these people try, they will not succeed. They will cause enormous damage. They will cause extensive damage, but they won't cause irreversible damage, because the human heart is what it is. And people know, they know when they're being lied to, whether they realize it or not. As the genius who wrote these reviews on Red Letter Media wrote, he said, you may not have caught it, but your brain did. And that's something I think we can all take with us. For Steve Green and Scott Ott, I'm Bill Whittle. This show is made possible by the members of BillWhittle.com. We'll see you next week right here on Right Angle.